It's been a minute, everybody. Sorry.
I know. Life kind of happened.
Got in the way. Yeah. Not got in the way. Yes, it happened. That's a much better way to put it. It happened. It happened. I think there's a lot of stuff.
The last time we did a perspectives episode was in 2022, right? I think it was 2022. I think we tried to do some in 2023, but last year was a weird year. Last year had such a different energy.
Yeah, it was a lot. So we're back now, which is good. We're going to talk about, as everyone knows, the Wicked teaser came out, not the trailer, the teaser premiered on Super Bowl Sunday. So that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk a little bit about the Broadway. You can see Brandon's festive background. Let's see both of them. Scoot to the right a little bit. There we go. We can see both of them. So we're going to talk about the musical and kind of just get into our first impressions of what we thought of the trailer. And the reason why I wanted to do this, because we talked on the phone a couple weeks ago. I was listening to The Big Picture, which is a big movie podcast on The Ringer. It's a pretty good one, but they did like a recap after Super Bowl Sunday and talked about the trailer, and neither one of them really seemed to know much about the musical or the history, and that drove me kind of insane, just as a lifelong fan of the show. And I'm like, I don't want people going into this movie thinking that it wasn't a Broadway play. Like, it's like, so it kind of was like, oh, I need to talk about this with somebody who knows as well as I do, because we've been following this show since 2005. So I guess a little bit of history is for anyone who doesn't know, the musical Wicked is based on the book Wicked by Gregory Maguire. The Broadway show came out in 2003. And so I remember kind of hearing about it vaguely. I think it was a Tony Award performance of Defying Gravity that my mom was watching. And that was kind of my first exposure to it. It was Kristen Chenoweth and Idina Menzel. And I remember I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. Like just being very, very impressed by it. And then somehow we were all at SFA, me, Brandon, and then our friend Shay. We were coming to Houston for the weekend. It was in town and we ushered. That is how we saw it, because three broke kids from college could not have afforded a ticket on my own. I don't know about you.
But I did have a white shirt.
We ushered the touring production. That might have been one of the first tours of it, because it was, by this point it's 2005, because it was like fall of freshman year of college, like real early on.
It was also one of our bonding trips. That was like one of our first like trips that we were like, oh, we could do this. All right, let's make this happen.
For sure. So, and the drive from Nacogdoches to Houston wasn't far. Like, I think the show was like on a Friday, because we ended up going to Austin the next day on Saturday. So we sat like, we were sitting higher up in the balcony, but we still saw everything. It was a phenomenal show. And then for me, like, I just became obsessed with the music for most of college. I feel like, you know, if you were a theater kid, you knew Popular, you knew Defying Gravity, you knew Kristen Chenoweth, Idina Menzel, it was just this huge, huge phenomenon, almost like Rent, I would say. It's like, my husband works for Broadway Across America, Michael, and he's, you know, Wicked's one of the megas. It's one of the, just the mega shows. People will pay good money to see it. They'll go, they'll enjoy it. They'll bring their kids. They'll go. Yeah. It's just, and it's a show you can pretty much bring someone who even is maybe not even into theater to it, and they'll have a good time. It's just a beautiful,
it's time. A well-oiled machine.
It is. They know exactly what they're doing. And that's kind of my history with the musical. I saw it again when it came, because it came and toured in Houston this last summer. It was July. I saw it on July 3rd, the day that it closed. So it was a Sunday evening. Still really solid. You know, by the Sunday evening, I'm sure everybody's like, oh, we got to do this again. I saw Frankie Valli's granddaughter play Elphaba. and she was wonderful. Glinda was very funny. But watching it this time, first of all, Defying Gravity still makes me cry. I still thought it was a beautiful show. But I think watching it now, after having performed all these years too, definitely gave me a little bit of a different perspective than I had when I saw it with you for the first time. But it's still, the experience was still just as magical as it was that first time. And I'm grateful I saw it a second time. So that's a little bit of my history of the musical, because I thought, you know, it'd be good to kind of tell our listeners about that first, because that's what this movie's based on.
It is. Well, I think, you know, I think it is. Yeah, I think this movie has history around it, or mm-hmm. maybe in this version, history. I feel like, you know, The Wizard of Oz, where this is all based around, is such a story that is forged by Frank Baum, the writer. And he created, I think it's 15 books based on this entire series of these characters. And the reason why I know that is because after watching this trailer, it made me go on Amazon Prime and download. For 60 cents, I could download all 15 books for onto my Kindle app. And so if for 60 cents, you can go on there. It's like, because it's such a literary work of history, you can download it. And I was like, you know what? I need to read this book. I've never actually read The Wizard of Oz. And so
no, I started reading it.
And I'm not finished reading it, but I will tell you, A, so much better than the book Wicked. I'll get into you in the
yeah,
whole
that's,
story.
No, that's fair, because I've read Wicked. It's an okay book. It's not anything to write all
yeah.
about. The base material is good, obviously. It made an entire musical.
Definitely. And for me, you know, Wizard of Oz as a book, I'm like halfway through. I really love how it's written. I could see why people find it so enchanting of a book and why it's done. It's still a story we keep telling over and over. I mean, this is a book that was published, I believe, in 1901. And then the movie came out in 1934, 36. Sorry if I don't have the right facts.
Yeah,
but it was in the it was like in the 1930s, the movie Wizard of Oz came out. And since then, we've had other remakes and other versions and other things. And it keeps like evolving and evolving. And I think for me, the whole reason why like this history kind of has brought it together for me is I've always loved Wizard of Oz. And Wizard of Oz and I have had a unique history throughout my life. So growing up, I learned about the Wicked book probably in about 2001. So as a kid, I read a lot. I just was like a bookworm. It just was like my way of kind of getting away. I mean, I watched a lot of movies and TVs, but I did love to read books and I loved fantasy books. And so I remember I got the Wicked book and I tried reading it and I could not get into it.
Yeah,
so,
it took me a minute too. I think I was just like going through the motions because I had already started it. So I was like, well, let me just finish. I feel the same way. I remember bits of it, but yeah, there's a reason why they changed so much of it for the musical.
They did. And I think so the musical, right before I had met you in my senior year of high school, so I was like 2004, 2005, we did, Wizard of Oz, and I got to play the Cowardly Lion. And it was a role.
I remember that picture in your parents' house.
Yes. And, you know, talk about that. Like, you know, everybody has those high school moments if you do theater, especially certain high schools, where that certain place affect a community. And there were certain roles that people did. And I think when we did Wizard of Oz, for the town of where I lived out, had a very Kansas feeling to it. It was very open, very, now Buda has changed and it's like become absorbed by Austin, but before that it was like you would feel like
I remember it was like a little cute little burb.
Yeah, it was, and it had like a lot of farmland out there. And so we did this show, I did Cowardly Lion, got this kind of connection, and Wicked had just come out maybe a year before that, or maybe a year before that, and I fell in love with it. I was so a Wicked kid, because musicals were I'm into musicals, and I got a degree in theater. I do love musicals, but I'm not the biggest like traditional musical fan. Like Rodgers and
Oh,
Hammerstein
see, I am. Oh my God. Love
has
it.
never spoke to me. I've always come into musicals through a Sondheim or through a kind of Urinetown or Little Shop of Horrors. I've always liked the alternative musicals a lot more than the traditional musicals. Now, I respect all that stuff because I've learned, and I think when you work within musical worlds, you understand that so much, it's not always the book that dictates it. It is sometimes the music. And like a lot of the earlier musicals had beautiful music that they had to build stories around. And so there's a difference of how that happens. But you get Wicked, and Wicked's like, here's this book, and yet here's this movie. And they smushed them two together. And what I think they really got rid of the most was always the book. The
Oh,
book
absolutely.
always, because
Absolutely.
the Wicked musical, what makes it so perfect is it's basically the movie
Yeah.
in a like
Literally
all
from her
power
eyes.
feminine story.
Yeah, and from especially the second act is literally told from her perspective. And I didn't, it's funny you say that because I didn't realize, for those of you who haven't seen the musical, we are going to spoil it, sorry. So if you don't want to hear about it, just come back and listen to it after you've seen it. The second act is basically Wizard of Oz. It is. It's basically the Wizard of Oz. And I didn't realize how genius it was until this time around when I saw it in July. I was like, it's so funny. If you've watched her get melted, you watch like, and then the way she's like, that stupid little girl has my sister's shoes. Like, it's a completely different, like, and but it's a, and it, and yeah, and like when there's a line that Glinda has where she's like, can you just like be nice to the girl and her poor dog Dodo? Like they're just so, you know, like from Dorothy's perspective, which we always see in the movie, it's like this really like the stakes are so high because she's just trying to get home. And then you hear from the witch's perspective, and it's just like, girl, you gotta just relax. Just please calm down and everything will turn out fine for you. So it's very smart how they do it. It's really, really smart.
Totally. And
So
I
I'm
think
glad you
that's
brought that
also,
up. Yeah.
but I also think that is also why, before we get into the content of the teaser, because it's a teaser trailer, it's not the real trailer, it's just a
Teaser
teaser.
trailer, exactly.
And they definitely did flashy things to entice people on the Super Bowl because it came out during the
They
Super
did, and it,
Bowl.
oh my God, and
And
it worked. Yeah.
it did. And that was the whole point. But I will say, I think on the context of these stories, the reason why Mick Wicked is a well-oiled machine is because it's a great theater representation of Wicked, and it's perfect. It's that type of theater that if you can bottle it, this is the closest thing you can do to like bottling a type of show that can endure for years because it's so precise and perfect in what it is. So why I say that is, if you compare, if you go into watching this movie comparing this new movie to that, it's gonna fail on every single year because it's not gonna be at all capable of doing what the theater can do because it's not a theater, it's a movie theater.
No,
So
that's true. That's a really good point. Yeah.
I think, and that's the whole reason why I started off saying there's been so many iterations of this story. My hope is that this is different enough that it makes it interesting for what it is versus trying to make it completely the same musical that, because if they're just trying to do what they did on stage, I don't think it's going to work. And I don't think they are because they're already making
No.
two movies of this. So I think it's going to be a Hollywood epic movie version. Some people may like that, some people will hate that, but I hope that they at least stay true to it being more of a movie than trying to like force it to be a musical.
I mean, it's coming out in two damn parts, so I think, like, so I'm gonna like, so before we get into it, can we kind of go over like our grievances a little bit? Because I had some, and it's probably it is the theater snob in me. I know that movie adaptations of musicals are usually they're always almost always different. There's some I don't care to see. This one because I love the stage show so much. Like, but if it wasn't for the stage show, this wouldn't even have an existence. You know what I
I
mean?
agree.
Like, the movie exists because of the stage show, not because of the book, per se. You know what I mean? Like, the book is just the blueprint.
Well,
But
totally, but I think that that's the point, though, is that they're all connected, though, in some
yeah.
ways. Like,
Oh, absolutely.
it's
No,
evolving
absolutely.
itself.
So when the buzz first started about this, I remember I was like, okay, to me, two parts seems a little excessive. Like, I don't know if I need a part one and a part two of this.
I know
I
what you
really
mean.
don't. I feel like that's a little excessive. I'm not crazy about it being John Chu because I saw Crazy Rich Asians. It's visually stunning. The movie itself, it's okay. That's just my opinion. And I saw his, we both talked about his adaptation of In the Heights.
Yeah.
Not
I
great.
know. I
So
know.
when I heard it was him, I was like, ooh, that's tough. This is tough. So that makes me a little bit skeptical. And then the two leads, I don't know. Cynthia Erivo, I mean, I'm vaguely familiar with her, but I have never actually sat and watched anything that she's done. Like, I know she was in Harriet. I know she was in the Aretha Franklin story on like the History Channel or something, but I've never actually sat and watched her do anything. Ariana Grande is Ariana Grande. Like, we all know, like, she's like a pop princess, but I remember hearing a clip of her singing the opening and she was able to hit like the soprano. I was like, okay, if they're gonna keep it like the soprano the way it should be in the role of Glinda, then I'm fine with that. If they make it like pop, that's gonna bother me. And I don't think they are. I think it's important that they stay true to the music. But I think the casting of Jeff Goldblum as the wizard is kind of genius. Because if you, the wizard is not that great of a part on the stage. It's okay. His like he's, but I think Jeff Goldblum's so weird that he'll probably bring something else to it that will work. And then I love Michelle Yeoh, and I love that she's playing Madame Morrible. Madame Morrible is like my favorite part of that musical, I think, probably because I'm older, and that's probably like I just it's a really really good part. And again, that's something else I discovered the second time I saw the show. So. And then Jonathan Bailey is Fiero. I don't know. It's either going to be hit or miss for me. The
Don't know
last
how I feel
Fiero I
about
saw
him.
wasn't very. I don't either. I wasn't like. And I know he can sing. I've heard him sing. I don't know what it is. I'm like, I don't know.
I just
I
don't know
wasn't.
much of his work, so if that's the thing,
I just
he's
know.
a
I mean, I
very
know
unknown.
Bridgerton. I know Bridgerton.
Yeah. I've
Yeah.
only seen the first season, so I do know him from that, and I like him in that, but I don't really know much of anything else. So my hope is that because he's someone unknown, and I did like him in Bridgerton, that he will be interesting. But his chemistry has to be with him and Cynthia Erivo.
Cynthia,
And so
yeah.
I hope they have chemistry. Maybe that's the thing. Maybe they will play out. I'm very excited for her. We're just gonna go straight to the moment that I think in the teaser is how people are gonna feel about it. How she's singing Defying Gravity in that little
Yeah,
moment.
the riff at the end, I don't like it. I
I
don't like
liked
it.
it, but I liked it because it was a different choice. And I think
No,
Cynthia
it's fine that
Erivo.
it's a different choice, but it almost sounds like she's flat for a second. That's the problem I have with it.
But I don't know if that's the final take that they're using. I feel like that, to me, that wouldn't be the final. Like, I think
Then
that that could be a cut.
they shouldn't have put in the teaser.
I think they did it because they just want to stir up controversy. That's what I feel like. I think they wanted to get people to feel everything. I mean, the whole thing felt so
Well,
like
that's
a
a stupid
marketing.
move. That's a bullshit move.
I think the reason why, why they're doing it though, is because they know people are going to rag on the movie regardless. Even if they made it like
Yeah.
super like cookie cutter, I think everybody, and I don't not saying that that's a good or bad thing. I just think there are people that are going to dissect this movie because of such history that it actually has. And everybody has a point of view or a connection to this story. And I think that that is what's very powerful about this movie world of Wizard of Oz into Wicked, is that everybody has some relationship to it. So I think they knew, let's just kind of like, I think they're going to be edgy with this one. I think that this movie is going to be. They're going to be long. They're going to have a lot of backstory. I think the best thing's going to be the music, obviously. I think however they weave, if they stay true to the music and weave it in well, my hope is that it's good. But my main concern is John Chu. I just don't know how he's going. Aesthetically, the teaser didn't make me turn it off. Like, I like the choices. It looks like the musical, but with a more movie kind of polish to it.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it looks like a lot of the same costuming, just a little bit more revamped and maybe more stitched for, like, the cinema, tighter kind of waistlines and less, like, kind of bold colors. But it still, it has that, it feels like the musical. And that's the one thing I did like. I love her glasses. I thought her glasses were cool. The ones that
I had. That did work nicely. Does she look a little old to you when she's all with the makeup and stuff, or is that just me?
I don't know.
Maybe compared to Ariana Grande, because Ariana Grande looks like a fucking child.
Yes, I agree. I think that that's the thing that I don't think Cynthia Erivo is too old to play the role. I
No.
think she's just, she has such a mature look compared to Ariana Grande. Ariana Grande looks like she's still in her 20s. And I think Ariana Grande is in her, she's in her 30s, but I think she still looks really, really young. Like, she looks like she is in her mid 20s. And I think that Cynthia Erivo, so Chris was watching the trailer, and the only thing that Chris got turned off, and he gets kind of turned off on these in movies, is when these movies have so many A-list actors, and it's just like, boom, boom, boom. And I think that that's the one thing, when I was watching it, I was like, man, they're not even hiding the Hollywood casting on this one. Like, they're not even trying to, like, make the casting feel believable. And I applaud them for just saying, whatever, we're just going to cast whoever we think is the best and is going to be
that's
the most.
I think that's fine.
Well, actually, but it is that, I mean, it feels like a Hollywood movie in that, right? Like, I don't feel like I'm sitting there watching the real characters. I feel like I'm watching Cynthia Erivo going to be Elphaba. I'm going to watch Ariana Grande be Glinda. It's not, I think that that's what makes Idina Menzel and Kristen Chenoweth iconic as the original characters on Broadway. They got to set the tone for those characters.
And they did.
They did. And it's always stayed true. And I'm not saying maybe some actors have not changed maybe a little bit, but the entire prototype is always going to be them first. People are going to always remember them as
it should be. As it should be. When you have that original Broadway cast assigned and you originated that role, like, you should be, like, your stamp should is always going to be associated with it, I think.
Which is why I think it's the hard part for Cynthia Erivo and Ariana Grande is not letting people get to them, because I think they're just going to be different. Like, I think that, like, when I saw that in the teaser, I'm just like, they're just such alternative choices to casting this project. And I'm not saying that, like, either can't work, but I do think that they are just interesting choices.
Without a doubt. Without a doubt.
And it's interesting because it's like, I'm trying to think of it as, like, in casting terms, but, like, the way they chose them, it's like, if you were to do Ariana Grande with somebody else, it probably would make more sense. Or if you did Cynthia Erivo with somebody else. But the fact that they decided to put the two of them together feels, I hope there's magic there. I hope
it's odd. It's an odd choice.
Yeah.
It's an odd choice. And it's, you know who also auditioned for Glinda, because she talked about it, was Amanda Seyfried. I was like, fuck, that would have been she would have been really good. Like, that's
yeah. If I had seen her and Cynthia Erivo,
that would have made more sense.
Like, but it's like, it's not that I don't think Ariana Grande is not a good actor. I think she's, I've seen her doing more stuff since she's finished filming this. Like, she's got more music videos. She just dropped an album. She did SNL. She seems more in her power, because I always felt like with Ariana Grande, when I've seen her in the past, she was like, I have good pipes, but she didn't always have the best stage presence. She just kind of, like, stepped around, stopped, and sang. She had an amazing voice. She's technically talented, but, like, her acting and her stage presence never felt like she had the same pizzazz. But since doing this show, it feels like, and I think that that's the whole thing, like, this show, when you do it, it like empowers you in a way that I feel like everybody that's ever still done the touring shows goes on and does stuff after. Like you get like this is like a
totally.
Role and the show that like gives you the ability to like kind of launch forward. And so I hope that the material elevates them both and surprises me. That's what I do hope for.
No, I like that. I think that's a really interesting take. And Ariana Grande did get her start on Broadway. She was in 13, the musical. Disney Channel kid, I think, right? Yeah, I think this. And
Disney
I
Channel
remember
or
for the.
Nickelodeon.
Yeah. For the Wicked, like, because this year was the 20th anniversary. Yeah, this year was the 20th anniversary. 2023 was. But they had done like maybe a 15th anniversary or something with Idina Menzel and Kristen Chenoweth. It was televised. It was around Halloween. And they hired a bunch of like pop artists to cover the songs. And Kristen Chenoweth, of course, sung Popular because, you know, but Ariana Grande sang The Wizard and I. And I remember I was surprised. I was like, oh, she's got a good voice. But I was hearing her sing an Elphaba song. Not that I don't think she could play Elphaba, to be honest, but I think I was not as excited when I saw that she was going to play Glinda. I think everybody was really divided on that when the casting was announced.
Definitely. I think, you know, though, Ariana Grande will surprise everybody, but Glinda's role is also in the first half. There's an arc. I mean, I'm imagining the movies are going to end after Defying Gravity. Like, I think the first film will end after they have Defying Gravity. Maybe there'll be like a little sequence after it, but most likely the second half is going to, this part two is going to be like a remixed version of The Wizard of Oz, because the whole first film is basically the backstory of her life, how she's born and everything, her going to the school, getting in good with the wizard, and then kind of losing everybody's trust. And so I think that this first film will be interesting how they depict it all. And I think Christina, I really like Cynthia Erivo. I think she's a very talented actress. I've seen her in a few things that I just always was surprised by, like the choices she made. I hope this is something she does really well with. That's my hope. I really would like her to like succeed in this one, because I think Elphaba is a great character. It's a great role. There's such levels to it. Man. And it's the music is amazing, but like, I mean, it's an amazing role. If she is challenged and she is like, she has to persevere. And I hope whoever directs her, I mean, John Chu, and I hope the team really makes her come off strong. I hope so.
Yeah, any woman would be super lucky to get that part. It's either of the roles. But yeah, Elphaba is like, that's a dream role. And if you can sing it, that's even better. So,
and I even, you know, there's a lot of actresses you could think about who could maybe play Elphaba right now, but it makes sense, Cynthia Erivo. I think when I think about it, like, who's like a musical movie actress, like a musical movie actress that they could have else cast as this right now? That, because I mean, Elphaba technically needs to be played by somebody kind of in their like, they kind of usually cast them around like late 20s into their 30s. I feel like Elphaba's a good cast. Sometimes maybe they play different. I don't know. I don't know the history of all the Elphabas, but from what I've seen, they seem like they usually are around that age range. So I'm like, who else could have played Elphaba that doesn't have at least some type of Hollywood infrastructure that they can use to like promote? Like, I think that this is, everybody knows, like, I don't know if everybody knows Cynthia Erivo. Everybody knows Ariana Grande to a degree. And I know that's being a little pedantic. I'm not saying everybody does, but Ariana Grande,
most
because
people
of her
do.
Music
Yeah,
career,
she's a name. Yeah,
she's a
name.
Name.
That
she's been in the
recognize.
Tabloids. So I think with the Glinda role, people are going to, you either like her or you don't like her. But I think this movie is going to really introduce Cynthia Erivo to like the like commercial audiences. I feel like that is what I, it's gonna be interesting how people, because not everybody knows who she is. Like, I don't, I know she's won Tonys, I know she's in theater, I know a lot of other people, but if I went up and like stood on the street and be like, do you know who Cynthia Erivo is? I wonder how many people actually know her. So this movie, I think, will really give her a chance to kind of show people what she's doing.
Yeah, I think so too. I think so too. I mean,
I mean, who else?
overall, I'm what's up?
Who else would you see as Elphaba? Who else could you imagine as cast as also Elphaba?
Fuck, that's hard. I mean, the Idina Menzel's just too, want to say old, but
Yeah.
she's past the age. I mean, she is, and she's talked about it
Yeah.
before, because I know that she, like, apparently from the time that they, apparently the movie was always going to happen, even when the original stage play came out. But they flat
Oh yeah.
out told her and Kristen Chenoweth, like, you guys won't be in it by the time we do it. Like, they flat out were like, y'all won't be in it. Y'all will be too old and it won't work. And Idina Menzel was like, well, what about, like, the thing they did in The Irishman? They made them look younger. And I was like, yeah, and that looks terrible. So it's just like, it's kind of a bummer that they were already cast out of it. Man, that's a really good question. Who could have played Elphaba? Who can act and sing? But who has that vocal range?
Who has that vocal range and who is a big enough star to headline a Hollywood movie like that on that massive of a sell?
See,
Like,
like I would think someone like Anne Hathaway, if she had that type of voice, would totally nail it, but they would cast Anne Hathaway as Glinda. They wouldn't cast her as Elphaba.
exactly.
She
And
has a soprano voice.
I also feel like Anne Hathaway though is too, everybody knows her. Like they, it's almost kind of like, just like the same chemistry, people, some people, a lot of people knew who Idina Menzel was when she first came out, but not everybody knew who Kristen Chenoweth was. You kind of had to like,
No.
she didn't have the same star power, but then that role fucking catapulted her off and she became the high-pitched singing voice lady, you know what I mean? And she did all the stuff and she did TV shows and whatnot, but it launched her. And so like I think in some ways, the producers are like, we've got to get people that are somewhat known, but also kind of unknownish. So it's like, it can't be Anne Hathaway. It couldn't be like Emma Stone. It's not going to
No.
be like any of those people. I think it was like, and they also knowing with how diversity is, and I mean, this is just like, as a
Yeah.
producer, they had to go with a diverse choice. And I think that at this point in time, having, they're both diverse choices. I mean, Ariana Grande is, I believe, Latina, or is she? Yeah. So I mean, it's like they went with a very diverse choice for both of them. So I kind of, that's what excites me for them, is that they, and I think it's really cool that like Cynthia Erivo is Elphaba because she's green. And it's like, she's like, you know, she's black, but she's green. And it's like an interesting thing because it kind of makes a statement on color in general in a weird way. I think that the movies are going to be, they're going to be movies. They're going to be weird. They're going to be kind of like, you know, movies are inherently weird. Even like commercial movies, like movies are not. I think the musical had to be on Broadway, edgy enough, but it had to be commercial. I think that these movies are going to be edgier versions of the Broadway musical. I think they're going to have sex scenes in them. I don't think it's going to be like sexy
Oh yeah,
stuff,
because the
but like,
one in the book with Fiero and Elphaba, that's real graphic. I was like yeah, and obviously they can't do it on. I didn't think about that. Yeah, you're probably right.
I think they're going to like, I don't think it's going to be like HBO at sex scene, but I think they're gonna have, I mean, there are some sexy scenes in the Broadway show too, like when they first kind of kiss, or in the second half when they're like having their whole magical spell and they're doing the thing together and they sing that song. I mean, the story inherently has a sexual nature to it, so I have a feeling like how movies are, they're gonna have a little bit of that. And also the now here's my thing, and this is why I keep wondering. I wonder if they're going to incorporate stuff from the book a little bit into it, because there's this whole sequence in the book when they go to like the city like they're at school and they go to the out and they go out to the, like this like dirty show or something like that. And I don't think they're going to go that far, but I just wonder how much they're going to incorporate that, because when I saw the teaser, that's what I kind of discerned from it. And that's what I felt like, maybe it's not off-putting, but maybe makes people feel a little bit like, this seems weird. It's like, it looks like Wicked, the Broadway musical in a movie form, but it also feels really edgy in a weird way. Like, just like the way it's shot, the way it seems like the mood and everything, it just seems kind of like, it doesn't seem like they're just making the musical. It's like they're going to do something
with it. Well, and Madame Morrible, she gets murdered in the book.
Yeah.
Elphaba murders her. So I'm like, I've wondered, I'm like, I wonder if they're going to do that. They could, but the movie, they don't
You're
do it
right.
on stage, but yeah.
The person that I am most excited to see, outside of, obviously we talked about the two leads, is Michelle Yeoh as Madame Morrible.
Oh, me too. Oh, she's going to be so good. She's going to be so good. And that,
I
and
did not
she,
imagine her.
No, me neither, but I think it works. And honestly, the role, like, so many great actresses have played that role, and it's a really, really good role. And it, you get to, like, you can kind of talk, sing your way through most of the songs. She doesn't sing that much. She sings a little bit in the beginning of Wizard and I. She doesn't have any big grand. So that role really is more about the acting. Not to say that the other ones aren't, but that one, you know, Madame Morrible has the, I think the wizard sings more than she does. So really, it's like, it didn't matter the route he was going to go on that, whether the actress could sing or not, you can learn that easy. And I think Michelle Yeoh will be phenomenal. And she looks incredible. They made her
She
very,
does.
Because Madame Morrible, in the, she looks like a wizardy witch, the way she looks in the show, in the stage show. They made her look kind of sexy, like she's got that hair, and obviously she's like tall and thin and just very so it's definitely just a different take than what you're used to, than what you see on stage of Madame Morrible, but I think it'll work.
So in November, when we are doing our review episode, because you know, everybody, I'm just gonna tell you, Adi and I are gonna do a review episode most likely of
we
this
are
movie.
Oh, absolutely. Of part one,
I think. Part one, yes. I think we're going to call this the sexy Wicked, because that's what I think it's going to be. I think now that we're talking about this, I'm like, oh Lord, everyone's going to be like, this is the overly Hollywood sex stuff version. And not just because like the actual sex scenes, but like everybody looks beautiful in the movie. Like everybody has the hair coiffed.
Yeah, they
in
really do.
The hair and the makeup look good. Like they all look very.
That one shot of Jonathan Bailey where her hand is on his face. Like, yeah, it's. Oh, for sure. For sure. Yeah.
Everyone looks like they got lasered in the face, like extra
I
smooth back
know.
lines.
I know. Yeah. But there's a lot of people we didn't see. Like, we didn't see Nessero. We didn't see Bach. We didn't see. So there's, I mean, it gave away very little. So I'm curious to see how it's going to be when the actual trailer does come out.
I agree.
And it's
I
Thanksgiving.
Agree, but.
So it's brilliant marketing wise. Like it's going to get a good, I mean, it's the numbers I feel like are going to be good. So there's a lot of anticipation behind it. So,
I think it's, you know, what I love about it, and this is like, not to get off too topic, but I am obviously, you and I have talked about my tarot cards and magical in life and my spiritual world. And I've been very open by making movies about witches, and I am, my own self, a practicing witch. It is exciting to have a big movie musical that is about witches coming out. Like that is like something on a fanboy level of somebody who makes my movie Earth Mother. And I was talking to Adi right before this about making my film franchise that's all focused on magical movies. It excites me to have something this big coming out that its main focus is about is about witches and wizards. And that, I think, is one of the things that makes this story really exciting. And it's one of the things that I loved when I saw the musical for the very first time with you in Houston. Movies and stories that are about witches and wizards have always been something very dear to me. It's been always a place of refuge, a place of magic, and a place of inspiration. And I remember that trip. This was like Adi and I had just really started becoming friends. And we went with our friend Shay, and we just went up there to Houston, and It was a magical weekend. We got to hang out with you and got to meet your family, and we got to go see this really cool show. And we had good seats, even though we were kind of sitting in the aisle. We had a great perspective of it. And I just
Sitting on the
remember being
balcony,
like,
but yeah.
and I just remember being mesmerized by how the musical and the story isn't about Dorothy. Because Dorothy adds, I mean, she's in it. Spoiler alert, she will show up early in part two of the movie as well. But she's not really in it. She is just part of the action that is behind everything that's actually happening in front of you. Because when you think about Wizard of Oz, there's such a human perspective. Dorothy is who you're looking at the world. So there's this like moment of her walking into Munchkin Land and everything feels fantastical. What's exciting about Wicked is it's not just fantastical, it's their world. They live in that. They build a society. They go to a magical school called Shiz. You know what I mean? It's a whole magical world, and it's all built around witches and wizards. And that, for me, as a filmmaker, as somebody who's making my own, that really excites me, because if people really do love this movie, or if it just makes a lot of money, that can help make other content of that nature get more funding, because it gives people a way of showing that there's an audience for this content. So I hope they go super witchy with it. I hope they don't do it in an off-putting way, but I hope they go witchy enough that it really makes people ex inspired and excited by something like this type of story.
Yeah. Agreed. Well, I'm excited. I'm excited to talk about it whenever it actually does come out.
Yeah.
Yeah, like definitely look out for the review episode, everybody, and just our thoughts on part one of Wicked. I don't know
We'll
when
probably
part two is
do
supposed to come out. When is part two
as
supposed to
part
come out? Like,
in 2025, in November of 2025, a whole year later.
oh, so they're filming it now. Or are they
No, they
done?
filmed it all. They filmed it
They
all
filmed
back
it
to back.
all. Okay, that's smart. Okay.
Yeah. Basically, like 2001 and 2000, or no, 2021 and 2022, or no, 2022 and 2023, they basically filmed the movies.
Okay, that makes sense. May as well just knock it all out.
Right? Get it done.
Yeah,
They're like, we're not going to make one and then not make the next one.
Because that would be, and then everybody's gonna look different if you wait. Like, yeah, no, that's fair. Okay.
I guess that's it. I think that's wrapped us up for our
I
perspectives
know this was a
episode.
good one. So we'll be
Yeah.
back. We will not wait this long to pod with
No.
you again. We should do one before I have my baby.
Yes. And then we'll do
So
one after you
I
have the
might.
baby as well, too.
Yes. 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 Yes.
Well,
Well, this was super fun.
love you.
Good vibes, love you. Bye, everybody.
Bye, everybody. Take care.